sustainable water initiative, or clean manufacturing, or providing sustainability policies that go well beyond just fuel efficiency and into everything we do. That's the way that kind of corporate social responsibility that's baked into who we are and what we do. We're not doing it because it's the cool and latest thing to do. We're doing it because we've been doing it since the early 1900s. So, our philosophy around social media is kind of borrowed from Woody Allen. You know, Woody Allen famously said 90% of life is just showing up. Well, we believe that 90% of social media is just showing up. Like, it's being where people expect me to be. I can open my laptop and my iPad on any night that American Idol is going on and see mentions of Ford flooding in based on people watching the program. Hey, Ford, your new Fiesta is awesome. Hey, Ford, your music videos suck. And they're automatically putting that at sign in front of it on Twitter without even knowing whether we have an account. Right? So it blows them away when we actually reply to that. Hey, why did you think that? Thanks very much. Well, get two responses. One, that's freaky. What did you expect? It's a public platform, right? Or two, that's so cool. A global mega brand just responded to me, an individual. Right? So, it's just being there. And we have a corollary to this philosophy that's informed by that other great American philosopher, Yogi Berra. It's the other half of this heart. Yogi's never good at math. The point is, it's what you do when you get there. And that's where people are going to notice the difference. Give you an example. Oh, before I do, here's just some examples of where we are across the web. Certainly we're all over Facebook. We actually just put together the beginnings of a tab on our main Facebook page. It's going to act as a directory for all of our global Facebook pages so people can find what matters to them. We've got customer service on Twitter. We've got a corporate Google Plus account, which we're piloting with the Google Plus development team. And we actually list a number of our social networks on thefourthstory.com, kind of our hub for social media. But again, that notion that it's what you do when you get there that matters, people pay attention to the quickness of your response. No longer is it acceptable to let something sit for 24 hours, or even 4 hours. People want answers and they want them now, because if you don't provide it, they're going to go to a competitor. And speaking of competitors, when you do it well, when you do it in a way that makes people sit up and take notice, they wonder if the competition is even there. So our effort is a global one, and it's not like, you know, we're going to be doing Facebook activities in China, right? Because China certainly doesn't allow Facebook. How do we take this and make it global? Well, ultimately, we find that there's a universality to some of this, a common language, if you will. One, people want good products, right? We demonstrated that with some of the lines we have. They want good content, right? That limited time that they have to spend with you. Think back to that ADD slide. And they want to make sure that it's some good content. They want you to talk like a regular human being, not like a press release. Or not like a lawyer. Right? I had a session with our customer service unit, and I said, how many people here have heard the phrase, we regret any inconvenience you may have experienced? I looked at him, and I said, yeah, who's ever said that to anyone on the phone? What do you say? He said, hey, I'm sorry you're going through that. Let me see if I can help. The same thing applies online. That's how people like to be spoken. And now, more than ever, they have platforms to talk back to us, and they want to have that opportunity, whether it's commenting on a blog, on a Facebook page, interacting with you on Twitter. It's important. But wrapping all around this is not only our ability, but our responsibility to listen, to monitor what's being said about us, to understand the public's perception and to be able to take action based on what they're telling us. Listening itself is fine, but listening and taking action means a heck of a lot more. So let me give you some examples of how we put some of these principles to life. And I'll start off with this quote. If you wish to persuade me, you must think my thoughts, feel my feelings, and speak my words. And this isn't something that Chris Brogan just came up with, or Seth Godin, or even somebody like Dale Carnegie. This was actually spoken 2,000 years ago by the Roman orator Cicero. They think about how universal human nature, how people are fundamentally the same as they've always been. What do we want? We want what's in it for us. We're looking out for our friends and family. But maybe we want to be part of something bigger than ourselves. Maybe we want to make a difference in the world. We're certainly seeing that a lot now from the younger, kind of digital natives that are coming through. They want to be part of making a difference. So, we allow this to happen through a program we call the Fiesta Movement. Part of our One Ford plan, the Fiesta, which was already under development in Europe, was then slated to be brought to the U.S. It's pretty much the same design. So we brought 100 of these vehicles over from Europe before they were available here in the States, and we gave them to 100 influencers for 6 months. All they had to do was produce one video a month for us, and we put it up on fiestamovement.com. In the meantime, they did what they always do. They were on Twitter, and Facebook, and YouTube, and Flickr, and their blogs, and they were talking about this life. And obviously, a good portion of that included the car, because they had something that no one else in their peer group had, or very few in their peer group had. And we made it all happen live here on our own website. Unfiltered, uncensored, unedited. People like me, talking about a fourth product. And that demonstrated a few things. It demonstrated, one, that we were supremely confident in our product in order to be able to release it into the wild as to where I let people talk however they want and amplify it. And two, it made us look cool because we understood what people were looking for. And we gave people an opportunity to find someone of these 100 people, whether it was geographic-based or personality-based or what have you, who was like them, who they could identify with it, who could talk very plainly. In the end, we saw over 7 million YouTube views of their 100 videos, almost a million views on Flickr, 3/4 million views of their photos on Flickr, 40 million impressions on Twitter, 132,000 people came to fiestamovement.com and said, yeah, tell me more about this when it actually comes to the dealerships. 83% of those people had never owned a Ford before in their lives. Brand new audience for us. Right? 3 out of 10 of them were under the age of 25. But we had an opportunity to create a relationship with a new way for customers and keep them for life if we do things well. Just this week, speaking of millennials, we announced that we created a partnership with Zipcar, where we are now offering the Ford Focus as part of their Zipcar U program to 250 colleges and universities nationwide, so that when millennials who are not prone to buying their own cars, there's a lot of car sharing, ride sharing that goes on, they'll be exposed to our vehicles, will be in their mind. And we know from experience that former Zipsters are actually influenced on their ultimate purchase decision when they do buy. Last summer, we decided that rather than taking the completely reinvented Ford Explorer and revealing it at an auto show like we always did, we would reveal it on Facebook and in 8 cities simultaneously, bringing it directly to the public. We will always, always reach our traditional media pool, the automotive journalists, business press. But in this case, we wanted to go beyond that. So we let our Explorer fans know early on, about 4 months before the process, that this is how it's going to go down. And we gave them content in engaging content along the way. Teaser photos, interviews with the chief engineer and the designer, people who are actually responsible for taking this 20-year icon and making it brand new again. And then on the day of the reveal, we lined up our broadcast team who was doing press coverage. We lined up our digital media team who did an extraordinary online advertising buy. And we lined up our social media team. And we put this tab together on Facebook. It gave people a menu of events for the day. Whether it was a live chat with Alan Lau, our CEO, or an exclusive video from Mike Rowe, our spokesperson, or an opportunity to see the vehicle reveal on video right there on Facebook first. And they could like each individual piece of content there. So not only did they like the Explorer page, but every time we gave them a new piece of content, we made that like as well, thereby increasing the chance.